Good morning and welcome to our monthly webcast. I am Sameer Mehta, your moderator. This is session number 149. We have another very educational, complex coronary intervention today. You may see both a chronic total occlusion as well as a bifurcation. Hopefully many, many lessons to learn. And of course, I'm delighted. We are exactly on time this morning. So to welcome you from the cath lab, here is Dr. Sharma and Dr. Kinney. Sameen, okay. Good morning. I'm actually quite surprised. I just walked into the cath lab to check. I thought this 36-year-old has to be an Asian Indian.
Yes.
very unusual. This is the youngest patient I remember we have done, at least for the coronary cases.
That is correct. Yeah, that's correct. Sameer, clearly welcome from greetings to all our CCC live viewers globally, which is now 160 plus countries. And we have very interesting case, as you mentioned, with the combination of total occlusion and the bifurcation. And next few months, actually, we will have some more total occlusion because there has been a demand on our the CCC webcast. That people want to see some more CTOs, because I think they learn everything about the calcific. We are taught quite a bit calcific lesions and so, but a little more on the CTO. So I was talking to Anu yesterday that we'll focus on that. Yeah. This catheter, damped. Yeah, come out of this. Yeah. So we're going to show this case. Want to show the, take a picture first. Good. Damped. Let's take a quick picture then.
Yeah.
No? Okay. All right. So with that note, why don't we start while we are taking a baseline shots, knowing that our motto for 2022 will be start on time. And that's so let's start. We started on time. Let's show our slides while we get to these are our supporters. We actually one or two more being added on now. Our Cardinal Health and Cook is new partner. Disclosures remain the same. So this is the patient, 34-year-old, as you said, presented last month actually with the 2021. Sorry, it's a there it should be a little mistake. It's a 924 with the non-STEMI. At that time had a three-vessel disease, CIRC, OM, RCA, and CTO, LAD. It looks like clearly CIRC was culprit, got the PCI. Patient had the risk factor of hyperlipidemia, obesity, chronic smoker, positive family history. So because of the CTO, he was started on clopidogrel, ideally should have been a ticagrelor. Well, I'll ask Anu why, usually in non-STEMI, we try to go with the potent 2 P2Y12, although data as we presented last month and few, that many studies, even in acute coronary syndrome, have come clopidogrel as good as the potent P2Y12 of ticagrelor or prasugrel. So this patient then was started on, he was used to take aspirin and atorvastatin, then added on clopidogrel, metoprolol, isosorbide, and he has this three-vessel disease, which will show with a minimal LV dysfunction. Patient had a PCI of the two vessels, and now here for the LAD diagonal bifurcation. So that's where we are. So when we have taken the baseline pictures?
Yeah.
Yeah. And we'll go through that angio first before we go on further.
So you're seeing the angio.
Yeah.
Dual injection.
Yeah.
Okay. So you inject the RCA first. Inject the right.
Okay. Came
inject.
Out.
Okay. That's good.
You need a little more injection. RCA had to be a little better injection. So this is the one does get collateral from the RCA. Isn't there some get from other side
no,
also?
No.
Why there's a damp of the left main?
No, nothing.
Ventriculization.
It's an RCA damp. It means deep engagement. RCA, yeah, good. Slow injection of the RCA, okay?
No, that ventriculization is the left main. Because of 7 French, we'll see. Okay, let's take a picture first, yeah.
Pulling back a little bit. Okay, slow injection of the RCA. Go. Oh, there's
RCA is a disease now? Is spasm?
Yeah. Inject.
Probably spasm, no?
Spasm.
Okay, let's give some nitro. It's not
give
uncommon because catheter went in. Yeah.
4 French.
It's 4 French, I see. Yeah, because catheter did vent inside. We are going to give a little medicine now. So let's evaluate the left system. Anu, you have a good picture. There is some left main seems to be here because of ventricularization. Show the hemodynamic on the bottom, please. You want to give nitro also on this side? Let's give nitro. Looks like patient has a tendency for a spasm. Mm. As we know, the spasm is the disease more for the young people.
So let's go back here. So left main, can you show also the hemos always side by side?
So what was the 924, right? What did I say? This patient's picture. Let me change there because we're going to go back here. 924.
So, Samin, in 12 or 13 years of doing these cases, I've never ever seen a patient with almost zero calcification at Mount Sinai.
Yeah, good. So, that is correct. So, I mean, this, I'm part of that is young age, no diabetes, and of course, no diabetes and no renal failure. So, all contributive, although a smoker, smoking also has shown. When I have our moderate to severe calcium, smokers were one of the predictor of a moderate to severe calcium in our database, which we published. So smoking always was there, but other factors are not there, yes. But you're right, almost no calcification, acute coronary syndrome on 924. Okay.
Now, can want you make a four so we can see our face also same time?
Get the side camera only, please. No need for the top camera at this time.
These are absolute classic cases in India. Huh?
Yes, that is correct.
30, so actually, you are right. 25 year old, 30 year old.
We have done 21 year old PCI and so on and so forth, very young people.
Right.
Okay, now here. See, this catheter goes in. Yeah. You have to give a little nitro.
Now it's good.
So just take a picture here so that we know that there was no spasm.
Okay.
See, oh, Benton, mid RCA.
There's something you can do. Or you give me a no torque, right?
Yeah.
Just goes
so
down.
Catheter kind of jumps, very pliable vessel. So
slow injection. Okay. Good.
Yeah. So that was all spasm. So at least we know. And this is a good LAD filling. See that? Excellent filling of the LAD.
Okay, move.
Yeah.
And a very nice size vessel.
Yep.
So once you're able to open that, the patient should get a lot of relief.
Yeah. So he does have, after opening those two vessels, he did feel definitely better. But mild symptoms are still, we didn't do any stress test in between. Because I think it's a part of the complete revascularization in young person. It's reasonable knowing that there is no infarction in the anterior wall. We'll see it here now. We are taking a guide pictures once again.
Okay. Good. Okay, inject the left.
Yeah, it's still long segment. Side branch, long segment. Okay. So let me just complete and then we'll ask another strategy. Go back to slides, please. Let's get your things ready. What you want to do.
Samin, yes, so what is the estimate of the duration of the CTO? Just an estimate because
no,
it would be
do
hard
not
to...
know. No, not known. Patient not has known. No cardiac issues. No known CAD prior to the present episode of September 24th. And this looks like chronic because of such excellent collaterals. And the idea is now that after having done the CERC and RCA, come back for the LAD CTO. And we'll do a mini crush in this young for complete revascularization. So didn't have a stress test. So in the AUC criteria, it will fall into that category. Low risk finding or non-invasive testing. When you're nothing, it is called put into the low risk finding patient or double medical therapy. So it will be appropriate. Okay, with that note, Anu, you want to just show the angiogram now. Let's go back to the angiogram and let's have our strategy lined out based on the things now.
So we can see the angiogram.
Yeah.
So it's a CTO, I would say, proximal.
Now, do you have any?
A large side branch. And after that, we see almost at least a 20 millimeter segment. And then there is, a, I think, a small to moderate size diagonal in the LAD subsequently after that.
Yeah. The whole question is this ambiguous cap? Do you see tapered versus blunt?
I think that's very important. It's a tapered tip.
Yeah, I think looks like there is a very small channel. Okay. So let's ready. Now you want to show the what the strategy will be. So go back to the slide. You have the guide wires, techniques, the guide wire app just released. You want to take over now?
Problem. Yep. Tell him to show this camera.
Yep.
Camera has to be different.
Yep. So guide wire aid.
Yeah.
Amongst the various aid just came out on Diwali. Yeah.
So this is the guide wire app, which we called it as a guide wire aid. I think I've gone through how the logo was made. If you see a G, that's IOTA. And at the sinus, you see the guide catheter that's engaging into the sinus. From there, the wire comes down. So it's a combination of a capital G and a small G. And you have in the capital G, the number 7, because this was planned number 7th app. So a lot of things, you know, creativity goes into the even making a logo of these apps. So as soon as you, so it's free to download both Google as well as App Store. You see, as soon as you enter CTO or non-CTO, so when you press the CTO, then you will start seeing all the CTO wires that are coming. So just a brief, you know, update on what these wires are. So we always hear fielder. So there's the fielder. The wires for penetration would be Pilot, Gaia Next. We have Miracle Bros, Confienza, Progress, Hornet, and then Astato. These wires are being used here in Sinai, and so many of the cases that you have done, you do hear this from us. There are several other wires. It's all what people want to use and what they get comfortable with. So I'm just going to go through some of the wires. So if you see that, the fielder wire, so you can start seeing if you check on each wire, this is how you will see it, who is a manufacturer, core material, important is diameter, tip load. Then you can see the coating. So the tip load is what is the important. Radio opaque marker, we are not that worried about. So this is how it goes. So the diameter of fielder, then you have the pilot, tip load of about 2.7. You see the fielder that we are going to use today is just has 1 gram. Many people do use a pilot. Pilot comes 50, 150, and 200. And then Gaia Next is what we'll be probably using. The Gaia Next 1, 2, 3. So most of these do have a hydrophilic coating. So Miracle Bros, one of the oldest wire, is the one wire that has a hydrophobic coating. So good thing about hydrophobic coating is the safety of the wire. That's number one. And number two, that your tactile feeling is also very good. You have a hydrophobic coating. Similarly, if you see the Confienza, which we do use a lot, the tip of the Confienza is actually non-coated, is hydrophobic, though there's a hydrophilic coating till the tip. Similarly with the Progress 200. There's a polymer jacketed wire, where I say it's a combination of fielder plus Confienza, but the tip has no, is a hydrophobic. Then the Hornet is made by Boston Scientific. So also what you see, the tapering. Progress 200 is tapered, Hornet is tapered, tip load is almost 14 grams. So Progress 200 is 13 gram tip load, Hornet is 14 gram tip load, 13 to 14. And we have used Astato in few cases. This is for the coronary. We have the highest tip load, which is about, you have both 20 as well as 40. Both of them we carry. Again, hydrophobic at the tip. So if you go, these are the various fielders. Fielder FC, Fielder XT, Fielder XTA for anti-grade, Fielder XTR for retrograde, Similar, all these things you will learn just by clicking on each wire. And then microcatheters, several microcatheters are available, but the commonest that we use here in Sinai are Corsair, Turnpike, and Finecross. So if you see here, if you go to the library of the microcatheters, Turnpike, there are several Turnpike. So there is a spiral at the tip, Turnpike spiral, the gold coated, then you have a LP, which is actually, if you see here, the tip of the LP is better. Then we have a Corsair Pro, but now they are Pro XS, which is, again, the crossing profile is very small. Now you may ask, why do we use Finecross? Look at the crossing profile, is the smallest. So today we are going to use Finecross in this case. So like we mentioned, this was a Diwali special that we released on Diwali day, November 4th. Several other things are available, both on the website as well as on the app. Most important, variety of CTO cases or other kind of cases, when and what to use these wires. That's the key people like to see, where, you know, cases.
Beautiful. So this we actually released, you know, we had a live relay to the TCT on 5th of Diwali. And since then, actually, there were tremendous downloads. Although with the what happens on the app, it's tough to count yet, right? Take some time to come back that how much has been the download after the TCT. Do we know exactly? No. That will take some time, but a lot of people were excited about this educational new venture. And I know that there's very little written about the guide wires in our interventional teaching. And I'm glad that Anu and we made this app, which will, and almost every wire is there, and you'll keep updating it.
Yeah. So, once so the wire library has over 130 wires. So yeah. We'd had to get permission. A couple of the companies did not give us permission, so those wires are not there, so we can't mention about it. So it was a big venture. We had to get permission from the company, and Mount Sinai legal department had to agree. That this is just an educational venture, and we are not using anybody's proprietary or IP by doing this kind of educational app.
And a lot of people did ask us about, just to complete on the microcatheter, Tornus. Remember, Tornus was the first one of its kind. A lot of people ask, we say that we used to use Tornus, but I would say that after Finecross and Corsair, personally, I don't see any use of Tornus anymore. Because I think that the usually routine, as we use here, the Finecross, and in tough situation with the latest the Corsair Pro XXT is a much, much lower profile, works very well.
And the Corsair comes with two length, 130, 150. 150 is for retrograde, 130. So the lengths, where the wires also come with various lengths. So those lengths are also mentioned. So. Yep. You were asking some question now.
Yeah, Samir.
Yeah, Anu, first of all, congratulations. This is enormous amount of work. And for whoever was the person or the team who designed the logo, just a beautiful, beautiful logo. And where I am really concerned, and actually I think which Samir just mentioned, I mean, the amount of updating you will require for this endeavor is just phenomenal, but a great aid, and I am sure our viewers will find it extremely, extremely beneficial.
Okay. Anu, tell us your strategy in this particular case, how you want to do it.
So we'll start with Fielder. Of course, you know, I always like just a regular Fielder. Yeah. If people want to go with Fielder XT because it is tapered, not a bad choice. Like I mentioned, it's always you pick a couple of your wires, couple of the tools, keep using them so you get familiar with that, and you just use keep using those wires and tools. So we'll start with Fielder, and after that, I have the Gaia Next 3 ready here. Gaia Next 3 already comes with a pre-made tip, so you don't have to make it. If you take a miracle, then you have to make a special tip that we have to do it. So I'm starting with we have Finecross and Fielder.
And Samin, till Anu described this so beautifully and graphically, you know, one has a perception, but something like there is a 20, almost a 40-fold difference in the tip load from a Fielder to an Astato. Unbelievable.
That is correct. Yeah. But I would say, don't use, I tell people that, you know, like many of the things they show in the TV that don't practice at home. I tell people, don't try a start at 20 or 40. I don't use it myself because those are a very, like a needle. Very aggressive wire. So unless it's a routine high CTO operator, I would definitely not advise those use because those, yes, success may be a little better, but then has a much higher chance of trouble. So but a start of 20 may be okay, but 40 definitely is like ultimate. There's nothing more than 40, right?
For now, nothing more than 40, yes. And, you know, a couple of the catheters come and disappear. From the market. We used to have a Santa Cross. We did show one, I think, a case with Santa Cross.
Yep. I think that too will be okay here. You need a little body. You see the wire went in to the funnel, but you need a little push, although it can go. There seems to be another occlusion. And so?
Gaia 2 or 3?
So this kind of case, I mean, question is always escalate. Do you escalate step by step or you just go to what you think going to succeed? I think we learn more and more is that go to what you think wire going to succeed. I think in Gaia 2 will go. Gaia 2 will go here. Yeah. Okay. Gaia, as you said, there is a very small tip comes in. Ready? So anytime when we take from these catheters out, make sure you put a little saline. Otherwise, some blood or air trapped in. Always just keep fluid-to-fluid contact. This is now Gaia 2 or 3? Okay, Gaia 2. All right, let's see. Gaia 2 works or go ahead to go to Gaia 3. Tell me when you see little dye. Yeah.
I think I'm going into the diag.
Yeah. That's fine. So what I say basically is put your fine cross, do a little kind of Fogarty, come back, you'll be able to see a little lumen, and then you direct your wire appropriately.
That's one thing. Or
what about a parallel wire, a second wire by the side? Yeah.
Now, parallel wire is if you have gone into subintimal, then you want to leave that wire subintimal and go with another wire, trying to think. So this is what people may not like because you see here how I'm advancing the fine cross compared to Corsair. The way the Corsair is made, it's a braided metal. So easier when you twist and turn to advance into the coronaries.
So Sameen, I want to at some stage today, I want you to comment on something which came up quite prominently in your... viewers would have noticed, we aggregate the important questions which were asked and from the October session, there were several questions asked and comments made both by Dr. Sharma.
This will not going to go.
Yeah.
About not using any of the dissection causing techniques for CTOs, and that you clearly felt that has both adverse acute and long term consequences, and that as a strategy, whether anti grade or retrograde, that has not been your practice.
Our teaching strategy, yeah. So every institution is different. I mean, whole field of the subintimal anti tracking with the cross boss and technique all have been based on that. But we actually have purposefully away from because the published data are it may look good acutely, but there are usually no side branches left. And the secondly, that is associated with higher restenosis in the registry. So we both antegrade as well as retrograde tight away from subintimal tracking, string ray and that concept. But yes, we know that in a long lesion, little bit of part of the subintimal is part, that your wire will go a little subintimal, but just a very short segment. Right. Because anytime you go subintimal, you will definitely clip off the branches. That has been shown, antegrade versus, dissection re-entry associated with a higher CKMB release, cardiac enzyme release. And of course, as I mentioned, that higher restenosis. So what happened is in the registry, they showed that once you do antegrade dissection re-entry, more patients come back with a CTO again versus if you did not do a dissection re-entry besides having high restenosis. So now, Anu, tell us what you did just now.
Can you give some dye in the
yeah.
LAD, RCA?
Maybe retrograde, we can get injection.
Yeah, I thought you wanted to give RCA injection.
No, but RCA catheter came out. No, it engaged again. That's a troublesome catheter. It goes into the mid RCA. If
well,
I ever need
that's because of being a four French also. No.
No. Even the five French.
Okay.
Yeah. Good. Now we put a four.
We put four.
Yeah.
Earlier even five went in.
Good. Let's take a picture. No, we don't need integrate, right?
No need.
Yeah.
No, so yeah, it's good. Somewhere there, you start in the lumen and then it's...
So this is now Miracle 6. So you changed to Miracle 6 for what reason? You had to tell our audience.
Because of the curve, I had to, since the
pre-made curve
went directly only into the diag, I had to get into the LAD. Yeah.
Exchange length run through.
Remember, before I started, I did mention the pre-made curve of Gaia versus I had to get in. Let me go back here.
Yeah.
So if you see here, the pre-made curve of Gaia was very small. It took me into the diagonal. So to get into the LAD, I needed a slightly, bigger curve for that. That way, I can only do that curve on the Miracle 6. So we took the Gaia 2 next out and then we made a curve and got into the LAD.
Excellent technique, not only your skills but also to demonstrate it. Hopefully it has been useful. The key there was, as Dr. Sharma pointed out, was getting the retrograde injection. I mean, it clearly demonstrated the path to follow.
Now, let me see if the corset does not move forward, we can
fine cross.
Fine cross. Yeah. What we'll do is we'll do the
balloon track.
So, Anu, there's a question which has been asked. Have you used the Astato 40?
Yes.
Okay.
Many calcifical CTOs.
Right.
What happens if you have a calcium in the level, the two things,
at the proximal cap.
Yeah. So these other wires, what they do.
Good.
So just advance.
Yeah. That's enough. No,
you remember those cases? Did you have to go down the escalation path or you just tried one wire and went straight into?
No. That is like a sixth wire.
Usually escalation means when you have seen the calcium.
So we are putting that.
That when you see the calcium, you do not, you maybe try filter for to see. Just you always should have a soft wire. Always to think maybe there is a micro channel somewhere you may be able to get through. Always try a soft wire first. Then you will progress, means quickly change. So you'll go to
now we are
whatever
extending
the
to
wire
the
of choice, through, the next one. Then Confianza, and like I mentioned, you see there, you got to, Confianza is up to 12. Good. Then whether you like a progress wire, whether you like Hornet wire, any of those you can use. And then go to Astato. Astato also same, I think try 20 first. Why in calcific lesion? Because if you have a chunk of calcium, usually these other wires get deflected.
Right.
And you either exit the vessel
or
your subintimal. That's also okay that you have a short subintimal course but you are able to re-enter immediately. I think in every case, every live case, we have been saying
filter to side branch
the way that let's dilate first. We have to do the CTO, that you enter at the proximal cap and exit at the distal cap. That should be the way that we got to focus how we want to do the CTO rather than think of subintimal dissection. So like here we said the CTO is 20 millimeters and that should be the goal, that we just entered at the proximal cap, exit at the distal cap and try to stent the CTO segment rather than come come out with the 60 millimeter stents.
Okay, good. This is a 2.520 high pressure balloon.
So if the CTO has, if the fine cross did cross the CTO, you can go with a 2.5 balloon. Otherwise, you may need a 2.0 balloon. Yep.
2.0 balloon, then 1.5, 1.0.
Our next app will be regarding device. We are going to call what's called as a device aid. So that will be helpful for many people to understand the various devices the cath lab carries. All the balloons that are out there.
Going up. Good.
See now how I'm just progressing, gentle forward movement. Yes, yeah. We are there. We crossed it.
So what we did is we exchange to a run through, exchange length run through.
300.
300. And then question, we still have to save the big size diagonal, because that's the whole case was the mini crush. Now in the end, do you want to show some IVUS or OCT in this case? Which imaging? I think people will like. Sorry, we'll go slow. Many times this moves fast, so you have to go slow. Inflation. Let's pull the wire back a little bit. Good. I'm going slowly. So watermelon seed happens when you do a little fast. And of course, to counteract, you can always do a wire side by side or use a cutting balloon. But just coming back to the point, your everything you tried, your wire went in. You can't get even 1.0 balloon. And then so there, then you go with a laser. So that will be the use of laser for uncrossable lesions. Wire went in, but we don't have a device that unless there is a wire that you would. Let's see the little die. Taking picture, anti-grade picture only.
Yeah. Now, this is not unusual that you see this kind of flow. Usually CTOs do have thrombus inside them. So this kind of flow is not unusual. We can give some vasodilators and get some better flow. So we will wire the D1. D2, we can leave it alone, right?
Yeah.
Or you think we should balloon that too?
I think balloon that too. It's
yeah, balloon. Yeah, yeah. Good size.
Large enough.
Yeah, I think I would say probably. Segment. Yeah. So D1, D2 balloon, 2020 compliant.
Huh? We can use this balloon only.
Same balloon. Yeah, we can use the same balloon. So good.
No, you 2.0. Then 2.5 may dissect it. So yeah. What I'll do is I'll use the same filter wire that I used earlier to go to D1. We'll balloon
2.0 20.
I'll take out the wire and then go to. Sorry, I'll go to D2, wire, balloon, take it out, and then go to D1. And D1, we leave it there, so we can do mini crush technique.
What happened to the wire? We had it. Get a new one.
If the Corsair had not crossed, then we will do what is called as a trapping.
Fielder.
So we will go with the
get new fielder.
2.5 balloon side by side in the guide.
Yeah.
Trap the wire. Take out the fine cross, and then we can use, other means we can go with various small balloons or consider laser. Now, laser, you want to do only because we saw the way we navigated the CTO. If there was any question that this CTO wire was subintimal, do not try to do the laser. There's a risk of perforation at that time.
Or a tortuosity.
Yeah. Calcium. Sure. If you think it is subintimal and all that, try to avoid a laser.
Sameen, are you convinced the diagonal is the first one is severely diseased? In some views, it.
Well, we'll give some bad. Nitro. Although proximal segment, it's about 60.
It is.
It's not very tight. I know a lot of people will decide based on the let's do the FFR and so. But we learn that with the DK crusher. 6 trial, that may not be the right approach. You decide angiographically, but you're right. We give a nitro and we see if it doesn't look bad, then you could just do a cross. A lot of data have come now that even 5-year, the data that you stent across versus you do a side branch, unless it's a disease. Now, biggest disadvantage here is that you have some intimal channels and you have to be careful that you're not extending those channels. Yeah. 2.0 balloon. Yeah, we are not given nitro. I think that will be the one vessel
now,
will perk up.
If I had more, if the wire would not go to D2, next thing you'll do is pre-dilate more. Dilate.
Exactly.
Yeah. Because we only did with a 2.5. We may have to do with a 3.0, pre-dilate, then try again. Any questions regarding
the 2 of 20?
Yeah, going to
compliant.
D2.
Okay, going up now. The D2 just came up. So idea would be D2 should be just provisional. Get a good balloon results. If ostial, maybe I use a 2.25.
But before we started, we did predict that D2.
That there is a, we saw that D2, yes. Yeah.
It looks small, but look at it. It's branching, mm-hmm. going all the way almost to the apex.
The nitro. Not do it
okay.
here? No.
You want to? Okay, go.
Yeah, good. Yeah.
Just this is the ostium. We are just a few millimeters in. Most of it is in the LED. So we are going to give some more nitro and make a decision.
Then
right.
Take a picture. Then we go to D1 with the same wire, same balloon. I think it's okay.
So also the GR catheter, once you know you crossed, you don't need the contralateral injection. Just remove that catheter out of the coronary ostia.
I thought you just go to the D1 with the same.
Yeah. So I'll take this wire out and go to D1 now.
Yeah, but why balloon out? You need a bigger balloon. Okay. That's fine.
It's 2.5,
no? Yeah. Fine. Yep. Okay, so now our goal is we are going to D1.
You have to address the more distal segment of the LED also. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think it is still the flow issue because there was good lumen
the retrograde, it didn't show any disease at all.
Yeah. Yeah. So what happened is it's not uncommon when you have comparative flow in the CTO till you establish the good.
Anti-grade
flow.
Once we need
you'll see a comparative and it will make you believe that there is some disease there.
You want to dilate LED with 3-0?
No,
before
we
do diag, so we can make a decision of the stenting. I would dilate LED now.
Okay.
Right?
No, I think you can put a stent soft plaque. Yeah, unless you want to get 3-0-20 or 3-0-30?
3-0-20.
Okay, 3-0-20 also. Yeah.
I mean, ideally we want a 28 stent in the LED.
Yeah.
And maybe what you want, 16 in the side branch, diagonal?
No, 20.
Or 20, long.
Long, we say long, actually, even 24. See that? Mm-hmm. Once you go, you had to go 24 there. But we are 3-0-20 here. No.
Give me the... hold on, this is a different balloon.
Yeah. Because diagonal is a little longer, question is even 24 will cover. Remember the key is, it's better to cover edge to edge rather than land the lesion, the stent in the lesion, even if moderate. So that's where the problem occurs. So diagonal, let's see the balloon size, length, but to me it looks like even 24 plus. Good. Okay.
This is a
3-0-20.
3-0-20.
So I would say that we take a 3-0-32 and 2.5-28. Because we use a Promus Elite other side. Down. We can see the diagonal length.
Why you need a 38?
Huh? 38?
No, why you need that?
32.
That long?
No, I'm saying 32. No, this is the you have to cover both diagonals.
Okay.
And take a picture. Okay. Let's decide now. I think 32 will be good.
Too long.
No. Cover after the diagonal, there is mild disease.
Okay, go up here. Okay, 3-0-32.
Yep.
And 2-5-24. Go up.
Okay. Bring both of them, we'll let you know. Good.
So, I mean, again, you would be using the same stent
which we did for both
the previous, yeah.
RCA, yeah. RCA and the SIR. What is this now? 3-0-32, yeah. This will be okay. Okay, now let's open the diagonal a little more first.
For the diagonal, you want to use a 2.5, no?
Yeah, 2.5, but here. The question is whether 24 or 28. Yeah. We are going in now.
don't connect in like reach.
Sameen, how was the experience of doing the live case for TCT?
Oh, phenomenal. Great. Both, we had two cases. The first actually was very part of the interesting that they want us to do the PROTECT 4 trial case, which is comparing high-risk patient with a low EF with the Impella versus the standard of care where balloon pump can be used. And the decision was needed to be made on the table, randomize the patient. And guess what? Patient was randomized to Impella. Could have been balloon pump. Could have taken all the thunder out. But and then wanted a case of the rotational atherectomy, which we have a bifurcation, a rotablation of the LED diagonal. So those were the two cases we did. And taught same our usual techniques for everybody. You know, you need a little distal. No?
I think it may be that, too big.
No, but you need to get the bend up.
We got it.
Okay. So this is where 20. So I think 24 will be okay. Question is, do you need? 24 will be all right. 24. So this is the 2.5. 20 and 24 will be okay. So we are ready. You always put a stent in the side branch first. Patient is moving now. Good.
Just hit two grays.
Okay. Yeah, so they did tell us that there are a lot of people on the hybrid Zoom. But in person were about 2,000 people compared to 25,000, 30,000, but still were there. So there were a lot of recorded cases. There are few live cases like us, and recorded live means the record have been done as a full moderation and so. But we suggested that we do the live, and we did both the cases live. Okay, now this is now 2.520. Promus Elite is going into the diagonal.
Okay, good. Open. Good.
Yeah, both. Once you're planning two stents and doing a mini crush, you need to have a 7 French guide. Otherwise, you can do a step crush or DK crush, reverse crush, all those multiple numerology. For that. And then question comes the big one, that do you do the POT? And that's where I'm going to show one slide data of one of the trial which aggressively has, which I would say methodically has answered this question. I know more lost of data of the POT were more on the science experiment bench in the test tube, Olmistan, you know, all those pictures and so, but real life, what happens? We have publication to answer that question, and I'll be showing that as part of my presentation today. Okay, ready?
Okay, some die.
Good.
Pull back a little bit more.
Which we want to pull back?
Dag a little bit. No. Okay, good.
Dag.
This is the dag.
Okay, going up now. The diagonal. We just brought one cell.
Nano crush. Mini crush to nano crush down. Yes, some ST changes.
Yeah.
Yes, we see that. Okay, good.
16.
Down.
And now question will come. That you come back and take the both wire and the balloon out of the side branch.
Little die,
good.
Good.
Okay, looks very good. Yeah, keep the wire there.
Cutting back a little bit, okay, LED.
Ready?
Yeah.
Going up?
Up on the LED.
Okay, going up now. The LED. This is a 3032. 16 atmosphere.
Go up again. Yeah. It definitely is ischemic. Look at the EKG.
Yeah. Good. Let's take both of them out. So we'll give a little nitro. Let's get a little verapamil also.
And then what we take want to do is go with 2012 to the side branch.
Yeah. Your ST is still there. Question is why? But this is some little microembolization.
Yeah, embolized a little bit distally.
Yeah.
So we're going to give nipride, nitro, verapamil, all the cocktail. Yeah.
Good. Advance the wire of the LED.
Yes. Keep going. We're giving the cocktail right now. Flush.
Where is verapamil? Yeah, so question is nipride. A lot of people like nipride.
It's getting better.
Yeah. So and EKG, actually, you see the EKG improved significantly. Yeah, let's take
flush,
a picture.
Flush, flush, flush.
Yeah, that.
Not. Good. Okay, ready?
Yep. Wow. Look
absolutely
at that.
Absolutely wonderful. I mean, just the size of the vessel and...
I think now you can change it to FM. This is a good case.
Diagonal looks...
Young guy, yeah. Guide little outlet ventricularization again.
I'm just seeing D2 is there. I was wondering whether...
And the D2 still remain there. Good. So now tell us what's the strategy, then I'll go to my presentation.
We recross and kiss.
Yeah. No, but are you going to do anything to the D2? That's one.
No.
And just do the D1 and so, right?
Yeah.
Now there is little ventricularization again. It's because of the guide.
Yeah.
Moved in, yeah.
Can we give more verapamil so his tachycardia goes down?
Why he's having so much ST?
Is
having pain? I give low pressure, yeah.
Amazing, yeah. How tachycardic he became.
Yeah. Okay. Get a 2.5. What here? 2.0. 2.12. Okay. So we are going to go through the regular process. Show the slides on the continue. This on the left side, when we come back for the kissing balloon.
That's
now,
okay.
Tell us the strategy. No. Do you want to do pot, bifurcation? No.
Nothing. I'm just going to kiss, no pot.
Okay. So kissing balloon inflation.
Yes.
So basically, we are going to the kissing balloon inflation. Go back to the slides and continue the angio on one side. Now, pulse rate is better. The heart rate has gone down. There's still little ST depression in one of the lead. Okay, so now we talk about two points. One is the key interventional trials from TCT 2021. Favor 3 China, Radiance Hypertension Trio 6-month data, and Disrupt CAD 1 year. Then focus review will be the ProPOT trial. That is proximal optimization technique with side branch balloon inflation versus final kissing balloon inflation coronary bifurcation lesion. Now, I have avoided the main FAME 3 trial, which is what against CABG, and that is what we'll talk next month, because the major lot of things, a letter to editor and in the various areas being discussed about FAME 3. So that I'll keep it for next month. So FAVOR 3 China, what was FAVOR 3 China? That was the sham controlled randomized trial comparing QFR guided and angiographic guided PCI. So now what is the QFR? Now you see here, so this, there actually have been a FAVOR 1-2 trial before. No. That is the quantitative flow ratio, knowing that we do FFR and IFR, we are the wires, we have to advance. Question is, can you from the CT, from like people do in CT angio, in the non-invasive, can you with the 3D coronary artery reconstruction and fluid dynamics, then you make a equivalent to FFR. And the data of the QFR we presented 3 years ago, the FAVOR 1 and 2 has shown similar data with the FFR. So good correlation. So therefore, they want to do now, in this case, that whether lesion selection for PCI using a QFR guided strategy might improve outcome compared with a standard angiographic guided strategy is unknown. That was the basis. And this is very nice algorithm. I'm sure with a lot of companies are involved in making this. So basically, you take the picture into 2-3 views, and then it make a 3D reconstruction. Take some time. Initially, it was taking 15 minutes. Now, take maybe only 4-5 minutes. But then it tells you the QFR. You see that on the right side, the QFR, just like what they're doing in the CTFFR, just without advancing any catheter inside the vessel. So that was the whole goal was in 3,800 patients, QFR guided strategy and angiography guided strategy. And you can see here, the goal was that if the QFR is less than 0.8, you do PCI. More than 0.8, you leave it. Now, what the question was, what is the sham controlled? What they did is, they did the angiogram, and after the angiogram, they asked the operator that you are in the angiography guided group, you'll do whatever you need to do. Second group, angiography guided says, okay, what you are going to do, tell us. Now, based on the QFR, you'll change your strategy. So, means you felt 80% diagonal lesion, but QFR is more than 0.85, then you are not doing the PCI of the diagonal. So, that was the sham controlled, and they were very, because we know a lot of gain in these trials is based on what patients feel. They kept a very good job of sham control. Greg Stone is the PI, and actually he's doing similar type study in one of the device in America, Corsira. So sham control is becoming very important. So baseline characteristics were identical. Majority of these patients have unstable angina, very few MI. But very interestingly, then the QFR guided group, 1900 patients with a 27 lesions, that QFR was calculated in majority of them. It took about 4 minutes, 4 to 5 minutes. That's a good thing. And you see that majority were treated. Some of were not treated. 24% were not treated. And therefore, the QFR group, originally they were supposed to do PCI, but QFR decided that do only QFR guided. Some, we felt no PCI, but QFR said is less than 0.8, do PCI. So that's the way it was. Patient with intended vessel deferral or unintended vessel treatment, deferral or treatment of vessel which you didn't think to do, happened in 4% and 20% respectively. Angiographically, majority got the PCI. Right here, a QR guided, rest is here, fluoroscopy time, your procedure time, lesion success were equal, but other things were fluoroscopy, procedure, contrast, all were lower in the QFR guided group versus angiographic guided. So good acute results. Now let's go, what happened at 1 year? That overall event rate, MACE, death MI and ischemia driven revascularization went down by 3%, 8.8 to 5.8, highly significant in this 2000 patient in each arm. If you take only the MACE excluding periprocedural MI, still there was a significant difference in favor of QFR guided PCI. And these are the individual endpoint as shown here. So seems to be that QFR guided PCI compared to angio guided PCI is simple to do, added a little bit of time, but overall was plus plus in all short and long term results. And even you take up non-procedure MI. So it seems to be that we'll have another thing in armamentarium to decide rather than instrumenting the vessel, you make a decision without it. And this is basically the favor 3 China, and I'm sure this QFR is going to come to America. I was in phone call one time with one of the people who are involved in quite a bit, and they want to bring the device here in America. So clearly, the favor 3 showed PCI, or the QFR guided strategy of lesion selection, improved 1 year clinical outcome compared with the standard angiographic guidance. Second was radiation hypertension trio trial. This was basically renal denervation by using the ultrasound, the data at 2 months before, that by using the renal denervation, you had a better outcome at 2 months, better control of the blood pressure and so, and now they showed the 6 month data. And basically 6 month blinded comparison between patient randomized to endovascular ultrasound, renal denervation versus sham procedure. And this basically was the same. They continue with the 6 months, added medication if your blood pressure was not controlled. The strategy-wise, as you can see here, that in denervation group versus antihypertensive used and so forth, overall adherence was quite good. And the most important data here, that is home and office systolic blood pressure and aldosterone antagonist used through 6 months. Just concentrate on the top one. Mean home blood pressure change. As you can see here, the p-value was not significant. 4 point different, p-value was significant in patient with the home blood pressure monitoring, but in the office blood pressure monitoring was not significant. So what they found that yes, it was helpful even at 6 months, but only in the home group, not in the ambulatory setting. And these are the individual points shown here, daytime ambulatory versus the home. And so there's 2 to 6 months, various endpoints are shown here. So basically overall, very safe device, very low complication, but something we will have soon, that we have some denervation strategy which has shown. Again, you say, well, it was only home blood pressure, not for the ambulatory blood pressure, but you know, we had to go with what is available. But I am hoping that we have some patients, some other device for patient with refractory hypertension or multiple drugs is available, that this denervation. So you want to show this case first? Let's show the end result here. And let's just stop here in between, and we show what where we left it. Yeah.
Initially, I recrossed with 2-0. You saw. So how the technique was, we had the fielder wire in the side branch. We deployed the strength of the side branch. So you'll remove the STS and the wire will stay in the guide. Then once you deployed your LED strength, you remove both the balloons out, and the same fielder wire we recrossed. Initially, I did with a 2-0-12 balloon. This was a 2-5-12 high pressure, 3-0-20 high pressure that we had previously used, the KISS that we did here.
Okay, and then this is the final?
This is the final cranial. Yeah. D2 is still hanging by a rope.
Is caudal. What about the segment proximal to the first end? There looks a little...
No, you see in the caudal view here. Okay. It looks okay.
Yeah. Mild disease was there. Yeah. So that rather than bringing to the ostium, the excellent result, great flow.
So
look
you
at the
think,
excellent flow.
I think the ischemia was from the guiding catheter, which we had noticed, or just.
I know, but if you think, I think he's a lot of spasm here, guy. If you see the left main, it looks okay now.
Now plumped up. See that after opening the vessel.
We gave a lot of nitro and verapamil again, nipride. With all that, just look at the left main.
The left main plumped up now. Look at this.
Look at
good
the
left main. All right, let's go back to our completion. So we are on time.
And look at the EKG now.
Yeah. And EKG is
completely normal. Completely normal.
Yeah.
Normal.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Very good. Now let's go to the 1 year data of the Disrupt CAD3, which was the IVL for calcific lesions, showing that acute good results at the short term. Now they presented 1 year data. Because remember, rotational arthrectomy has been shown good acute result, but higher subsequent restenosis for deep wall injury or thermal injury and so. So this has acute results for good. We know the MACE was about 8-9%, largely because of the non-QMI. Overall good results at time 30 days that were presented last year. Now 1 year, overall event rate of 13.8 in these patients with a cardiac death, PVR and MI. MI remained the same, almost no much increase in MI, and these are the individual endpoints with the stent thrombosis of less than 1%. Then they did a subgroup analysis that which subgroup were predicted were higher MACE rate with the IVL, and only group was lesion length more than 25 millimeter. No A-sex, diabetes, renal or bifurcation. And the indigenous predictor of MACE were bifurcation, prior MI, and smoking. So basically conclusion was that overall that IVL works very well, except that the long lesion do have a higher MACE rate. So coming back to the important point, which we have been teaching, and I have one publication on the pot versus kissing balloon dilatation, that what is your OCT lumen. This was a randomized trial, pro-pot, proximal optimization technique versus final kissing balloon inflation in bifurcation coronary lesion. This is the first of the randomized trial for the pot. And this case, only thing was that these patients were, as you can see, not large group, about 120, but OCT guided. Whole purpose was, what is the stent expansion? What is your malapposed stents and so? And more importantly, that they took all patients, although left main were only 4%. So this will not apply to the left main. The left main was only 4 to 5%, actually 4. They have individual segment of the bifurcation lesion, A, B, C, D, E, which usually we talk about, that what happened to the area of the stent opposition, stent expansion, and so, and OCT guided. The procedure time, pot, fluoroscopy time non-statistically a little higher, but more importantly, that amount of contrast, as you can see, much higher with the pot versus non-pot. Now, what it did is, wire recrossing for the side branch was about 10 seconds lower with the pot versus casing. And you want to comment on this?
Now, when did they do the pot?
No, it's patient, the once you did a pot and now you go to the side branch,
no,
you did a side pot, branch dilatation.
I mean, did they do the pot before or after? That's the question.
No, it means the pot was done and then you go to the side branch. So pot group had pot and side branch inflation. So pot had the pot done, side branch inflation, then complete the pot. Kissing balloon technique was, you did a kissing balloon dilatation. So it did help in wiring the side branch. So that is one point. So more important is here, QCA. Look at the instant length, particularly diameter stenosis was 18.5% in the pot group, kissing balloon better lumen. It was 15% diameter stenosis. So kissing balloon lumen, kissing balloon technique has a better lumen compared to the pot, the of the main vessel. Side branch about remained about the same, but more important point was the particularly from the OCT point of view. So overall, after your pot or you do the kissing balloon, your malapoge struts were significantly lower, but were identical in two groups. That is the key. And this is the key. Lumen area on the OCT with the pot and not pot, they did have that trend. See the pot, the lumen was 6.7 versus 7.1. So definitely kissing balloon gave you a better lumen than pot. You know, partly could be that you are not opening the entire area completely. And so worried about, and then eccentricity, malapposed struts, and so identical between two groups. So this is the most important advantage we saw. Only thing is, look at the malapposed, maximum malapposed distance in the core distal segment after the bifurcation. It is higher in the pot compared to the kissing balloon dilatation. Because what happened is, with the pot, you never open the distal after the bifurcation. And so we were always worried about, but overall outcome were similar with no difference in stent thrombosis. So this basically, they put it as a central figure that malapoge struts rate assessed by final OCT, primary endpoint at bifurcation core, pot and kissing balloon dilatation identical, malapoge struts, jail strut rate at bifurcation core, pot has higher compared to kissing balloon. And as I showed you, the residual lumen by the angiogram by QCA was a higher residual lumen in the pot versus kissing balloon. So that's where we have. So basically, the conclusion was pot followed by side branch dilatation did not show any advantage over conventional kissing balloon technique in terms of stent apposition. However, excellent midterm clinical outcomes are observed in both the strategies. So coming back to the point, let's complete it. We are 3 minutes above and keeping it within 1 month, our 60 minutes. The first QFR guided versus angio-guided revascularization strategy, multiple thumbs up. Second, endovascular ultrasound renal denervation versus sham control, hypertension, plus minus. So some in the home monitoring better, ambulatory positive, home better, ambulatory negative, so plus minus. Third, IVL for calcific coronary lesion, 1 year outcome, thumbs up, 2+. Then in the pro-pot randomized clinical trial, proximal optimization technique followed by side branch dilatation failed to show superiority over final kissing balloon inflation or coronary bifurcation lesion in terms of stent expansion, malapoge stent struts or clinical outcome at 1 year. Therefore, pot strategy was associated with a trend towards higher contrast volume use. Hence, routine pot strategy with side branch dilatation, at least in non-left main lesion, because left main was, although a small number, but left main was only 7 patients, is not beneficial and I would say not recommended. So, Anu, you want to say the pot where you think should always be done?
Left main definitely, because of discrepancy between the size of the left main and the side branches. For non-left main lesion, same. If you think the proximal vessel is larger than the distal vessel, you should consider pot. But we have shown bifurcation stenting of LAD diagonal where we routinely never do pot. Where you may need pot, where you ask the question, why is it difficult to enter into the side branch? What is proximal optimization? That the proximal vessel, the stent is not fully opposed to the wall. So when would that happen? Not in a case like this, which is soft plaque. If there is a calcific lesion and we think we have not prepared the vessel well, and you know, in Mount Sinai, we always teach lesion preparation. So we will do, if there's calcium, we'll do some kind of atherectomy. Then if we think the vessel is not fully open, just on fluoroscopy itself, then we would do a cutting balloon, then we'll go high pressure balloon. So you have to make sure the calcium that is around the vessel wall has been taken care. And then when you place a stent, we know the stent has fully, you know, opposed to the vessel wall. If the vessel was not fully prepared and the stent is not fully opposed to the vessel wall, now there is a gap. That is where what is going to happen is your wire will try to go into that, you know, between the stent and the vessel wall rather than to go into the lumen. That is a situation, I think, where you think in a non-left main port is essential. Otherwise, we have shown several cases even here. You make sure your wire goes into the lumen. Fluoroscopically, you can see that you're in the stent and just get into the side branch. Should be easy. So it was statistically non-significant how to recross. But, you know, always, again, it is the discussion that do you do even in the left main port first or recross first. Many times recrossing of the pot also could be difficult because now you're crushing the stent, side branch stent and the main vessel stent. Recrossing could be difficult. So there are pros and cons, but you know, all these things is covered in that bifurcated app that we have.
And more important, yeah. And more important, the case which we just did today. So I know the whole country, or I would say world, has gone pot. There's no data to support it. Right. And we actually saw even your malapposed struts after bifurcation were higher in the pot group compared to non-pot. Because what happened? Pot, you decide based on the proximal vessel size. And you are not, after the carina, you're not expanding that stent that much. So malapposed struts were a little higher in the pot group compared to kissing balloon. So that's what we did like today here. Kissing balloon, that's what we have been teaching. So let's come back
to the question is, yeah. We were the first one to publish, which came out in Neuro Intervention. To say no difference between kissing versus pot in non-left main, showing same the OCT as well as the QCA, the flow through the vessel. There was no difference because what the in vivo study, people keep talking in the in vivo study, is that when you do kiss and not pot, the vessel becomes oval. In pot, it becomes circular. So that is not true. We are happy that this study was done so that people will know. So we always keep telling you that when you have two wires, there is entanglement of the wire, recrossing the wire, multiple balloons, all this takes longer time, risk for thrombus formation. You saw this patient did have some EKG changes because of distal embolization. The longer the time, more fluoroscopy, more dye, and risk for complication. So the goal is how to do this complex cases with fewer steps so you come out with the excellent result.
That's the key, fewer steps and less time. So following statements are true regarding the results of the FAVOR 3 China trial comparing QFR guided versus angio-guided revascularization, except overall less PCI done in the QFR group versus angio group. Overall MACE rate was lower in the QFR group versus angio group. Lower contrast use in the QFR group versus angio group. Higher periprocedural MI in the QFR group versus angio group. And lower TLR in the QFR group versus angio. Clearly, periprocedural MI was lower in the QFR, so wrong statement. Second, following statements are true regarding the one-year outcome of IVL of the DISRUPT CAD3 trial, except almost no new MI after 30 days. Overall MACE rate remains low, 12 to 15%. TVR was low, less than 10% at 1 year. Bifurcation lesions and prior MI were predictor of MACE. And MACE rates were similar in short or long lesion, 25 or more than 25 length. Answer is no. Clearly, there was higher MACE rate in the more than 25 millimeter lesion length. The last third question, the following statements are true regarding the results of the PRO-POT trial comparing POT followed by side branch dilatation versus KBI, final kissing balloon inflation strategy, except overall MACE rates at 1 year is low and comparable between two groups. POT was associated with higher stent thrombosis versus final kissing balloon inflation strategy. POT was associated with higher residual stenosis in main vessel stent versus final kissing balloon inflation. Malapposed struts were similar between two strategies. POT was associated with trend towards higher contrast use and similar procedure time as versus final kissing balloon inflation. Answer clearly is B. POT was associated with higher stent thrombosis. No. stent thrombosis was zero in this study of 120 patients at 1 year follow-up. With that note, we conclude our this month's one case number 149 of CCC Live.
Sameen, a very useful presentation of three important trials, and I'm glad you asked Anu to share her practical position regarding the use of POT. Just reviewing, I thought between the three, really, it is the follow-up of the DISRUPT, which is the most pragmatic. And it really is unsurprising that for longer lesions, there was a slightly higher TVR. So very useful trials. Anu, a beautiful case. Congratulations to your team for another lovely app. We are going to stop here and see you on December the 21st for session number 150.